Okay, thanks so much. Good day, everybody. Welcome to this Council on Foreign Relations Flashpoint Roundtable on the Future of Sino-Indian Rivalry. Thank you all for joining us today. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Paul Stairs. I'm a senior fellow at the Council on Foreign Relations and director of its Center for Preventive Action, under whose auspices this roundtable series is organized. As you are doubtless aware, the situation has been very tense on the border between India and China since early June, when there was an armed clash on the border near the region of Ladakh. Although both sides have since reached some kind of agreement, if that's the right term, to try to disengage, lower tensions, and prevent another flare-up on the border, observers remain deeply skeptical that the situation will remain peaceful indefinitely. And there's also seems to be broad consensus that what happened this year marks potentially a watershed moment in this evolving or growing rivalry between India and China, and that it will only intensify in the coming months. Here to discuss the situation, we are fortunate to have two excellent analysts. Firstly, Tanvi Madan is a senior fellow at the Brookings Institution and director of the India project there. She has written widely on Indian foreign and security policy, and particularly its relations with the United States and China. Her most recent book, Fateful Triangle, How China Shaped U.S.-India Relations During the Cold War, was recently published by the Brookings Institution. She will be joined by Yun Sun, who is also a senior fellow but at the Stimson Center and director of the China program there. Her work is focused on Chinese foreign policy, and particularly its, its relations with neighboring states. She too has published widely on these topics. Now, as typical in these roundtables, I'm gonna have a conversation with Tanvi and Yun for about 20, 25 minutes, and then we'll open it up for Q&A, and we encourage you to all get your questions in, and because things can get a little tight toward the end. So just again, a reminder that the discussion today is on the record. We will record this and post it on the council website, and I think it will also go up on the Brookings and Stimson websites too. Okay, so why don't we get started? Tanvi, let me just sort of ask you first to give us a kind of scene setter, and Yun, you should jump in too if you want to add anything, but just give us the sort of the basic background of what's been happening since the beginning of this year. Why did tensions suddenly flare up? And you and I'd be interested in, you know, what triggered this from the Chinese side, and what are the broad motives that are really driving this issue at this time. So Tanvi, why don't you just give us the bare facts on what transpired?
Thank you, Paul. It's great to be on a panel with Yun. We've been discussing this now for the whole summer. We were just saying we hope it doesn't last too much longer, that we enjoy doing this together. Just to set the scene in terms of where this boundary incident, this crisis at this point is taking place. This boundary incident, these incidents are happening where in the western sector, which is one of the India-China boundary, which is one of the three sectors between them. This sector is essentially an undemarcated boundary. There is a line of actual control that separates the two militaries. And there's a kind of set of land, which I think about as the equivalent of boatman's land that both sides claim. So it's overlapping claims. Now, from about 1993, for about 20 years after that, so till about 2012, over two decades, the two countries had five or six agreements that were set up to govern the conduct of the two militaries in this kind of boatman's land where there are these overlapping claims, some of which the kind of rules included, you know, the kind of weapons they were going to carry or not, patrolling patterns that both sides would patrol, and they'd have patrol, each side would patrol at different points, that if they did come across each other, how would they interact? And an agreement that neither side would establish a permanent presence in these areas. Since 2012, though, there have been four boundary standoffs between the two countries, four military standoffs, three of which have taken place in this western sector. There are questions about does this have to do with the fact that after kind of an initial number of years of Chinese infrastructure buildup on its side of the LAC, India had started building up the infrastructure on its side, and so that the two sides were just kind of bumping up against each other a lot more, or did it have something to do with Xi Jinping coming to office, given that there had been these number of boundary standoffs? In each of the, so from the way the Indians see it, is that in each of those cases, and particularly the first, the three boundary standoffs, including the current one that took place, they see this as resulting from the PLA taking unilateral action, kind of threatening force or using force to essentially change facts on the ground, to change the status quo in kind of violation of the agreements. So in this case, very briefly, what they believe is that in early May, and that's when the boundary crisis has been going on since, that in early May, that the PLA moved at multiple points on the LAC, at the LAC, sometimes in one case across the LAC in the Indian mind, that they moved at these multiple spots to either do one of two things, either establish a permanent presence or second, hinder Indian patrols. Now, there were agreements because these agreements that the two sides had signed over 20 years also created a couple of mechanisms. One, a military-to-military mechanism to have discussions, and the second, a diplomatic mechanism where there, it was essentially represented at assistant secretary level, where they would talk about these frictions if they took place. There was an agreement to disengage, de-escalate from these points. In the course of this de-escalation and disengagement, it's really, well, the details are still kind of not quite certain about how that happened. On June 15th, a clash took place at a place called Galwan, which was it resulted in the first fatalities that we know of between the two countries in 45 years. Since then, the two sides have kind of gone back to the negotiating table. There was a flare-up again at the end of August, where the Indian side said we moved because the Chinese side looked like they were going to move at another spot. The Chinese side said India moved first, and then we did. But there was also some firing then. And so that's where we stand, where since then, the two foreign ministers met in Moscow for a separate meeting, but they met on the sidelines, agreed to a five-point program to essentially kind of try to de-escalate, stick to the agreements, and then if and when the situation eases, to try to update these agreements. In parallel there, these military talks have continued. And so today, in fact, there was the seventh round of these meetings, but as kind of Yun will also point out, these discussions haven't really gone anywhere. So at the moment you have about 50,000 Indian troops and 60,000 Chinese troops kind of deployed in these areas, ahead of kind of when winter really sets in these very high altitude areas in November.
Okay, thanks for that, Tanvi. Let us return to some of the diplomatic progress that's been made since then. But Yun, I want to ask you, if you can give us the Chinese perspective on this. Why now? What were they trying to accomplish? What are the motives behind Chinese actions? If you can just give us, again, a very quick rundown from China's view on this issue.
Sure. Thank you, Paul. And thank you, Tanvi, for that beginning remarks. And I think Tanvi has already covered most of the major events that have taken place since May. I'll focus on how China has been interpreting things and has been interpreted. So coming to the motivation and why China is doing this at this time, there are two schools of explanations. One believes that China is on the offensive, and the other one believes that China is on the defensive. And evidently, I think the Indian side tend to see China as the aggressive offensive player in this round of the crisis. And I think there are some legality or some justification to that interpretation. And it would see the Chinese actions on the western sector of the disputed border as a component of China's aggressive and assertive foreign policy in 2020. And this is a continuation of Xi Jinping's assertive foreign policy since he took power in 2013. And with the wolf warrior diplomacy that we have witnessed out of China this year, that this conflict with India on the eastern, on the western sector is a premeditated strategy that China had been planning on. And there are arguments saying that China has been planning on this crisis since the beginning of this year, including dispatching troops from the military exercises held in Tibet to this disputed area near in Xiachen. And I think the explanation for that Chinese plan is this is a Chinese retaliation to the Indian decision last August to revoke Article 370 in the Indian Constitution and establish the Ladakh Union Territory, which in later Indian government official statements had included Xiachen as a part of the Indian Territory. This is the offensive school, and the defensive school believes that China was acting out of a weakness, out of vulnerability. And this is because China saw that with COVID-19, China's international status and international image was already severely damaged, and China felt it was besieged by multiple players on the international arena. So therefore, when India started infrastructure construction in the Western sector, the Chinese believed that India was exploiting or capitalizing on China's weaknesses in the international relations. And because India's international external environment has improved with the Indo-Pacific strategy, the Chinese would believe that India was utilizing the Chinese weakness and Chinese distraction to expand its control of the disputed territory in the Western sector. And the Chinese would say that, oh, there's a pattern of this. In 1962, India was exploiting China's 3 years of famine. In 1967, India was using the Cultural Revolution that just happened, just started in China. And in 1987, the Chinese argued that India was exploiting on China's fighting with Vietnam on their disputed border. And in 2017, during the Doklam standoff, the Chinese argued that India was capitalizing on China's damaged international standing because of the South China Sea. So I think both schools would have some legality, some legitimacy to it. But I think one thing that both schools probably would agree that there's a common point, which is Xi Jinping's strategic personality. That if you look at how the 2017 Doklam standoff ended, I would say that Xi Jinping never got over the Doklam standoff and how China lost face from the ending of that standoff. And as well as the falling of abrupt and unnatural, almost artificially engineered rapprochement between Xi and Modi, because China was fearing that India would join the Indo-Pacific strategy. So I think for Xi Jinping, his style is he's going to pick up his face wherever he lost it. So I think that component, that leadership psychology, played a pretty big role this year in the Western sector of the disputed border. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Yun. So Tanvi, you mentioned that there's been some discussions. There was the meeting in Moscow in September, this so-called five-point consensus. I want to get a sense of, you know, will things just settle down for a while, particularly when the weather is bad in the Himalayan region, and then things will pick up again in the spring. So, you know, what are the immediate consequences, and what can we expect in the immediate future between on this particular issue? And then we can maybe talk about sort of longer term issues in their relationship.
I think so. One of the things is, and this is why the motivation question is both very important, but also very hard to actually figure out. You've had kind of the Indian foreign minister essentially say, we don't know why the Chinese did this publicly, and say that, look, you can have differences. And you've had other Indian officials say this and other former China hands for India, that, you know, you can have these differences and insecurities, but in the India-China case, in fact, far more than the India-Pakistan case, there are all these mechanisms to discuss differences. And there's, in fact, a consensus amongst Xi Jinping and Narendra Modi. It is, in fact, we are exactly on the one-year anniversary of their summit in southern India last year, where they repeated the consensus that they wouldn't let differences become disputes and disputes to spill over into the larger relationship. And that these mechanisms could have been used to discuss to discuss these differences, and that, you know, in international relations, that responsible states should not be taking these unilateral moves, and militaries should be taking these unilateral moves to change the status quo, even if they have insecurities which can be discussed. And so the question is, you know, if the motivation was, and now there have been some recent statements from the kind of Chinese side that indicate that what they are looking to do is establish and consolidate what they call the 1959 claim line, which is the kind of the furthermost point of their claim. Now, if that is the case, if that is indeed the case, then it in Indian minds suggests that what they were trying to do essentially salami slice, or what in the India-China context is called nibbling, to their way to that line, and that if they really want to consolidate and, you know, take over everything within that line, then that's going to be in trouble over the next month and a half, because China has not so far taken all the land that it claims. And so hence the kind of everybody being on high alert. The concern now is that the rules of engagement have changed for both militaries, I suspect, not just the Indian side, because they're expecting that either side starts. So what the worry is that they could lead to kind of a spiral of each side thinking the other, or one side trying to move. I can talk about kind of why there might be escalation. I think the danger of escalation is still there. And there's still a window till about November, because this is a very high altitude area. The areas we're talking about is anywhere about 14,000 feet to 17,500 feet. But they're already close to dropping below zero in terms of temperature. The weather will get, but there is a space of time till about November that they can take actions. So I think we're in a little bit of a sensitive zone. The military channels remain open, the diplomatic channels. Some think that the only way you have a discussion and agreement about this is for Xi and Modi to interact. But there's also not much hope. There's this 5-point consensus. They've essentially agreed to things that they've agreed to before, and the challenge is to stick to the agreements. And so I think while people are happy, I think, as you said earlier, Georgia is better than war, there is still very much either due to an accident or deliberate or a misperception of what the other side is doing, that they will, that they could actually be escalation even now.
Yeah, I want to pick up on what you said earlier about the different interpretations of Chinese motives. Do you see this, what has happened this last year, as a real watershed in Chinese-Indian relations, and I'd like Tanvi to jump in here from the Indian side, and that there's always been a sort of strategic competition between the two countries, but it's now moved into the realm of rivalry. And I know international relations scholars draw a distinction that rivalry, strategic rivalry, means a sort of a deliberate effort to see your adversary as a potential enemy. And relations have now moved more toward rivalry than and away from just strategic competition. Do you see that this is what's happened this last year has really been a pivotal moment in the relationship, or are we still in a period where things could go either way, and we could move back into a more benign relationship or more cooperative relationship, or have we gone beyond that now?
Thank you, Paul. That is a great question. I think, is this a pivotal moment? Based on my conversation with the Chinese and the Indian colleagues, I think this is certainly a pivotal moment for India in its relations with China. But whether the Chinese think this is a pivotal moment for China's policy towards India, I do not see those. I do not see those evidence. So I think there's an asymmetry in terms of the perception of the severity and the implication of the crisis this year. But I think it is fair to say that both the Chinese and the Indian threat perceptions of each other have exacerbated after this Ladakh crisis. And I think there are a lot of people on both sides who would argue that no love is lost, given the longstanding issues between the two countries and the deeply embedded distrust of each other's strategic intentions. So in that sense, what we're seeing as Ladakh crisis is may not be a watershed event. It's just a natural continuation and almost a culmination of the strategic distrust between China and India. Because if you look at the bilateral relations between these two powers, it's certainly multidimensional. this border dispute is only one aspect of their relations. And I guess many could say this is only one aspect of the standing issues or long-standing issues between the two. There's also Pakistan, there's trade imbalance, there's issue of Tibet, there's issue of Dalai Lama. So I think there's a long list of issues or problems between China and India. Well, the border tension is evidently the most acute one. But like you said, you're absolutely correct. Distrust and problems are fundamentally different from hostility and a confrontation or strategic rivalry, because the hostility, strategic rivalry would indicate active policies to undermine the other side. So I'm afraid that looking down the road, I think the policy and attitude from both governments towards each other is going to harden quite a bit. Mm-hmm. I think people expected this to happen after the Doklam standoff in 2017. But I think for a variety of reasons, it didn't happen. And we saw this artificially engineered rapprochement between Xi and Modi, which was unsustainable. And it suggests that the leadership diplomacy cannot erase the longstanding problems between these two countries. So until the two governments find a pragmatic way out of this border dispute issue, I think it's very unlikely for us to see a quick resolution or for tension to die down. Thank you.
Tanvi, would you concur with that? I'd be interested in how public opinion has shifted in India and the sort of elite opinion toward China. Has this been a watershed moment from India's perspective, at least?
I think, to put it in one word, yes. I think there is a sense that the part of the reason this will be a watershed moment is that while India and India-China relations from Delhi's perspective had been competitive, it had not been adversarial in the last two decades or so, in the sense that what the agreements that I'd mentioned had allowed the two countries to do was put the boundary issues in a box. And by putting them in a box where, you know, the rules of engagement, of behavior, the code of conduct had been set aside, that you could then move forward and progress in a number of other areas in the relationship, whether economic, whether cooperation in global governance, whether kind of greater connectivity and engagement between people to people ties and civil society, etc. That it laid the groundwork for that. And then just in the last few years alone, you'd seen kind of, for example, Chinese investment in India grow pretty significantly. So that had been a good thing in the relationship. And it had allowed them, even if not to resolve a lot of their disputes, to essentially manage them. So not erase them, but figure out a way to manage them and allow progress. I think there's a sense in government and amongst kind of India's, and this is what's interesting, is across the China hands who have been the ambassadors to China, who have seen this relationship, who helped establish those agreements, they see this as an example, a vivid example of having been a violation of those agreements, and that there is no trust. So that even if they get out of this, that whatever agreements are then signed, there will constantly be a sense that China might violate them at any day. And so what this might mean is that the line of actual control will look a lot more like the line of control between India and Pakistan, which is forward deployment constantly. So you can't move back because you can't trust the other side to stick to the agreements. So I think that's one change. I think the second big change in their mindset is that, and this is the, I would say, the government as well as kind of the strategic community, that there had been this idea that economic, much like there was in the US, that economic engagement could help alleviate political strains in the relationship. That's pretty much gone. And I think the third kind of change you've seen is this sense, and this is the difference, I think, between how China and India see this. The Indians say, look, till you restore the status quo ante at the boundary, so as it was in late April, we cannot get back to normal in the broader relationship. Whereas Chinese officials have essentially been saying, look, let's set that boundary issue aside. Let's get back to, you know, we're both developing countries. We need to focus on the economy. So there's a basic kind of difference here. As for public opinion, it has deteriorated considerably, both as a result of China's early handling of COVID and the boundary crisis on top of that. And it's resulted in all sorts of things, including a much higher awareness and support for Taiwan than I've ever seen. And much more kind of intense anti-China sentiment that it was the kind that used to be reserved for Pakistan amongst the Indian public. I will say the longer this continues, and this is why I think it could be an inflection point, the longer the boundary crisis continues, the Indian government is not just saying that this will have an impact. They're putting in place a slew of policy measures that are restricting or putting extra scrutiny on Chinese kind of involvement in the Indian economy, in the telecom sector, in the technology sector, in educational exchanges. And the longer this continues, I think that kind of decoupling, if you will, I don't particularly like the word, but at least some disentanglement will get further and further.
Right. So I tend to sort of distinguish between what I call sort of vertical intensification of the rivalry and horizontal intensification or expansion of the rivalry. And you and I'd like to sort of get your sense of both what Tanvi was saying about this deterioration in the bilateral relationship and it evolving into both economic relations, trade, technology, TikTok, and so on, but also in terms of the sort of the horizontal spread of it. And can you sort of give us a sense, the linkages in the Chinese mind between issues that are central to Chinese security and what's been going on with India? And particularly, Tanvi mentioned Taiwan. That's obviously of a core interest to China. But if you could just give us a sense of where you think this rivalry is going, how it could spread and escalate in a particularly dangerous fashion.
Thank you, Paul. Well, if we look at the Chinese strategic assessment of its external environment, the assessment of India as a secondary problem and South Asia as a secondary theater has not changed because of this crisis. And it's unlikely to change in the future, even until China solves the Taiwan problem. However, the events this year have forced China to come face to face with a long list of factors in a real scenario with a war with India. So more importantly, this two-front war scenario, which is China and having a war over Taiwan on the West Pacific, and at the same time, having a problem with India on its western border, has forced China to face the reality that any of its action on Taiwan could trigger India, what the Chinese call adventurism, along the disputed border. Just like Chinese believe that India's border movement and infrastructure developments this year capitalized on China's distraction and weaknesses due to the COVID-19. So although India has remained a secondary threat in China's playbook, the needle of China's policy towards India has also moved. Maybe this is not the inflection point. Maybe I don't think China will ever, at this point, define India as a primary threat, but the needle of the policy has moved. If anything, China's tolerance for a bad relationship with India, including a conflict if imposed, has increased. So this is categorically different from the previous conviction that China is and will always be risk averse in South Asia, and therefore would avoid a conflict with India at all costs. It doesn't mean that China will actively seek a war with India, but it does suggest that China is prepared to defend its military positions even if a conflict is inevitable. So in this case, I think the Chinese have already made a determination that they will not be the paper tiger, quote, coach. Some Indians have inferred from the outcome of the Doklam crisis. And on the horizontal spillover of the impact of the military crisis or the military conflict potential, I think the Chinese are okay with that, because if you look at the Indian attitude towards Chinese BRI, it has been pretty rejected from the very beginning. And even though that China had tried to enhance investment and enhance trade with India, the level of investment and bilateral trade is still exceedingly low. And the more trade there is, the more deficit India will run against China. So there's almost an argument that this trade relationship, because of how unbalanced it is, is actually a point of conflict instead of a point of economic interdependence or cooperation. So if the Indian decision is that India does not need economic cooperation with China, and India does not need people-to-people or social exchanges with China, I think one, that is not new for the Chinese, and two, that is not unacceptable for the Chinese. So looking at the Chinese public opinion towards India, I don't think friendliness would be a word that I would use to characterize Chinese public opinion towards India for the past, I would say, several decades. So this is, of course, related to the government's guidance, the Chinese government manipulation of the public opinion. And the Chinese, for example, the government sanctioned reports on India has always focused on how chaotic the Indian democracy is and how diverse the Indian social problems have been. So I think among the Chinese public opinion towards India, the attitude has never really been positive. So in that sense, maybe this is another reason why this is not really a huge pivotal moment for China's attitude towards India, because maybe the Chinese never had a very high expectation to begin with. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay, so we're at the 30-minute mark, and I encourage those on the line to ask questions. And I hope that in the Q&A that we will get into the role of the US in not only this dispute, but in the larger relationship between India and China. And I'd also hope that we could talk a bit about maybe third party mediation, whatever that might look like, to try to maybe at least lower the temperature of the territorial issue. So I'm going to turn first to Jim Shear to ask the first question, and then we'll turn to Tara Hariharan. Jim, if you could unmute your microphone. Yeah,
I just did. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Excellent. Well, thank you, Paul, and thanks to our speakers for shining a bright spotlight on this issue. I have two questions that really go to the issue of motives, Beijing's motives, and my apologies, I came a little late, so if you've already discussed this, please let me know. What is the domestic impact that Xi would see from pushing this issue within China? I mean, what is the domestic impact in China of Xi pushing this boundary issue, especially in provincial areas in the West, as well as in Beijing more broadly? Does this help strengthen loyalty to him, or is this more divisive in some ways? And secondly, from the PLA standpoint, and this is more of a military operational issue, is there some benefit to the PLA from moving from what I'd call the line of actual control to a line of preferred control? I mean, does this help to in terms of logistics or maneuver, help the PLA if things get worse? And there was some recent discussion about how things could get worse in this Taiwan Strait and other areas. So so those are my two questions. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Jim. Maybe Yun, you take the first half, and maybe Tanvi, you take a crack at the second one.
Sure, I'd be happy to. On the question of the Chinese motivation, well, if you look at the Chinese foreign policy this year, the priority has been shifting, right? Before the COVID-19 broke out, the priority for China was to have a trade deal with the Trump administration. That was achieved on January 15, 16th. And then following that, China very quickly went into this state of crisis management related to the COVID-19 and the international negativity associated with China being the origin of the COVID-19. So that primarily took China's attention from February to, I would say, in April. That's when multiple claims of compensation about over China has emerged. So throughout April, I saw the Chinese very busy defending this type of, we saw the Wolf Warrior diplomacy, China trying to defend itself and trying to rally international support. And then into March, if we recall, Chinese priority for May in the following months is the national security law for Hong Kong. And the May 20th inauguration speech by Tsai Ing-wen for her second term. So I would say in the month of May, the Chinese attention were primarily bogged down by the issue of Hong Kong and Taiwan. And there was not much attention being spared to the issue of Tibet, to the issue of India. And I think this is partially why the Chinese government's manipulation or their effort to agitate the national public opinion and the nationalism in China was evidently weaker compared to the aftermath of the Doklam standoff in 2017. So, and also in 2017, we saw verbal threats coming out of Beijing, coming out of not only the PLA, but also the Chinese foreign ministry. But this time, most of the statements about the border dispute had come out of the Western command of the PLA. So I would say if you look at take all these factors into consideration, I think it is very difficult to say that this was a premeditated, well-planned, well-calculated Chinese war strategy to gain territory on the Western sector of the disputed border. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Tanvi, if you could just try to take a crack at what's to be gained by the PLA for moving the line of actual control potentially to its advantage. How could it do that? And what does it mean? That would be helpful.
Sure. So I think there are a couple of elements to this. One is that, is it about consolidating Chinese claims to Aksai Chin as a whole? And in that case, it's more about securing potentially what Aksai Chin has always been important to Beijing for. And this was an argument, in fact, that was made in the 1950s, that the reason, and this is how this boundary crisis really spilled out into the open, when the Indians discovered that the Chinese had built a road from through Aksai Chin. And the reason it was important for China at that time was that was the only road really connecting Tibet and Xinjiang. And so it was much more crucial, whereas for India, the Northeast, which is where in Arunachal Pradesh, what China calls South Tibet, that was a more settled area, that was more crucial. And so one of it is that these moves could potentially is about consolidating, taking some territory to consolidate the position in depth areas. The second aspect is there are about four or five locations where this has happened, where these movements have taken place. The one that perhaps is the most strategic is the least talked about right now is not the lake, which a lot of people, very vivid, great tourist spot, but not quite at the moment. But this is further up north, and it is where the Chinese apparently have been hindering some Indian patrols. It's unclear if they've actually established a permanent presence where they didn't have it. But this is an area called Depsang. And the reason that is crucial is it is very close to the point of India's kind of base at this place called Daulat Bay Goldi, which is about 17,500 feet or so. It's where India has an advanced landing ground. It lands C-130s there to supply its troops. But also Depsang is close to this area where China and Pakistan connect. So in fact, it's a more strategic area for India, but it could potentially also give, if the PLA actually does consolidate claims in those areas, it then gives it an ability to both link up, either actually link up with Pakistan, Pakistani kind of, partners, or at least hold that threat over India's head and require a diverting of troops and resources. So I think there are two aspects to this, and it really depends again on, how planned was this in the beginning, and, like in Beijing or anywhere, there's this debate within India, is this a bilateral issue, but how do you separate it from, Chinese moves against Japan, against Taiwan, against Australia, against Canada? And so there is this kind of real debate, is this about the PLA making operational gains or just, something broader that's happening in Beijing?
But most of what's been going on since May and June has been a sort of a build-up on both sides of their relative infrastructure and the ability to reinforce the area. But in terms of the deployment of any other systems that could provide a sort of a decisive advantage, that hasn't happened as far as I know. Can you confirm that, Tanvi or Yun?
I mean, so you might have kind of more kind of information on this too. We haven't seen this kind of buildup at the, so I think in scale, also in the sense of certain platform, there are more tanks on those planes now than we've ever seen before. They're more, I mean, both have more sophisticated view of what the other side is doing because of intelligence platforms, including access that at least India has via the US. So I think in some senses, we haven't seen this kind of deployment. And it's, even though the China-India gap, if you look at it overall, China spends 3.5 times of what India does on a military budget. But at the boundary at various spots, they're actually usually kind of more evenly matched. So It really depends on which point at the border boundary, but we have seen platforms now being deployed that we haven't seen before. So I think those could make a difference. I mean, the other thing that is going to India is actually used to deploying soldiers at these heights because of the India-Pakistan border and the Siachen Glacier. It's done these kind of round-the-year deployments at high altitude and kind of freezing sub-zero temperatures. For China, this is the first time they're probably going to stay deployed through the winter at the India-China boundary, at least. So it'd be interesting. That's kind of the other one difference that you see in this this area. And India usually moves back as well. So this is going to be a different winter for both of them. Mm-hmm.
Okay, let's turn to, I think next in line is Tara Hariharan. If you could just say who you are, Tara, first and ask your question.
Thank you. My name is Tara Hariharan. I work for a global macro hedge fund in New York City. My question exactly pertains to, Paul, what you were alluding to earlier, what the United States stance on what is going on is right now and what it might be. Because it seems like, for instance, if we look at Congress remarks regarding China and geopolitics, a lot of the fire and fury has been focused on Taiwan and relations with Taiwan. We haven't really heard a lot of readout from the U.S. side weighing in on the U.S.-China debate. So I'd love to hear your views on the current state of affairs, but also if we do have a political transition in the United States and we shift to a Biden administration, what the outlook would be like then as well. Thank you.
Okay. Yun, do you want to take a first crack and then Tanvi maybe add to it?
Sure. I'll give it a try. I'm sure Tanvi has more information on this front. At least from the current administration, the criticism or the condemnation for China's aggressive behavior in the disputed border with India is evident. And as recent as 2 days ago, Secretary Pompeo was calling China out for deploying 60,000 soldiers on India on the disputed border with India. So I think that position is quite clear from the U.S. perspective. And I think based on the result of the standoff and the crisis this year, there's almost a natural convergence between the American and Indian perception of China being the disruptor of the regional peace and stability and being the disruptor of the international, underminer of international norms and also existing commitment as China's obligation. So I think the shared threat perception between US and India have increased as a result of the crisis this year. And I think this has led to some movements on the bilateral front between India and US. And this does not only include the foreign minister meeting in Tokyo on October 6th, which was last month. Although a joint statement was not produced from that foreign minister meeting. And we have seen some fast tracking of the defense cooperation between US and India at the same time. So I think that's a quite clear indication as for what has happened under the current administration. Whether there's going to be a different policy under the Biden administration, we don't yet know. But I think a lot of people expect that there will be some shifts despite the bipartisan consensus on China being the problem, being the threat. But the format, the manner and the style, and also the implementation of that bipartisan consensus under a Biden administration is going to look slightly, well, depending on which angle you look at, it could be moderately different from this current administration's position. So if there is going to be some, maybe not substantive changes to US-China relations, but at least in terms of the optics and in terms of the formality, how things will be different, that could impact how India and US will closely align their positions vis-a-vis China down the road. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
So Tanvi, it seems that the US sees this as an opportunity to strengthen its ties with India, to consolidate this notion of an Indo-Pacific strategy, the Quad, and build stronger relationships throughout the region. And how are those general sort of policy preference on the US side, how is that being received in India, and Indians sort of leery still of being drawn closer to the US versus India, versus China, excuse me, or have they more or less made up their mind that they have to sort of put their lot in with the US and its allies in the Indo-Pacific? Tell us a little more from the Indian perspective.
Sure. So I think, you know, for one, they've seen that the US is the only country, both from the administration and members of Congress from both parties, that has actually called out China by name on this. The Australians and the Japanese have kind of alluded to it, saying, you know, countries shouldn't take unilateral steps to make changes in the status quo. But it's only the US, so they've seen kind of this rhetorical backing, even if the US, for example, doesn't actually pass judgment on the actual dispute itself. It, on the in the Eastern sector, the US recognizes Indian claims, but on this, it doesn't actually, so it's more about Chinese behavior. And you've seen the two governments have been in regular touch since the beginning of the crisis. And I think you saw a little bit of a turning point after the June 15th clash, where initially you saw the Indian government signal to interlocutors here that, you know, don't say very much publicly, because we, if you get involved, if you guys get involved, it'll become a US-China thing and the situation will escalate. We want to sort this out with the Chinese ourselves. We have all these mechanisms. After June 15th, they clearly signaled that they were happy for the US to make statements. So you saw a lot more, more of that. A few other things that we know of, that there have been reports of, the fast tracking of military equipment, but India is also deploying a number of platforms that it's bought over the last decade or so from the US. So, you know, the reason I mentioned this is, and intelligence sharing as well. Now, the reason I mention these things is that what this has done is kind of reminded Indian officials in some ways of the utility of the US, which is whether it is in diplomatic forums like the UN Security Council, where the US and France have now been playing the role that Russia used to, which is back India versus China. But also in terms of military equipment, India is doing everything from buying kind of winter gear from Alaska in kind of a hurry, to kind of even working together with like-minded partners. So in this Quad meeting that you mentioned. And so I think they have, on the one hand, they're already something. So this is gonna, you know, result in a reinforcing of the trend to move closer to the US. But there were certain things that India was hesitant to do before that we've already seen India do. So I'll mention three very quickly. One is, in normal times, if there was a India-China kind of border incident going on, the Indian side would have been reluctant for the quadrilateral to meet as a ministerial level in person. And yet they agreed to that. Second, we saw a P-8, an American P-8 maritime reconnaissance aircraft refuel on the Indian Andaman Island, which India was very hesitant to do. And third, you saw in the kind of middle of a crisis, again, India would have been reluctant to do certain visible things with the US out, you know, concern about provoking China, did a kind of maritime exercise with the US aircraft carrier. And so I think India sees this as proving that the US is really important for both India to build its own capabilities, but also as a balance at a time that it knows that it cannot ensure a favorable balance of power in Asia on its own. Mm-hmm. But they will not put all their eggs in the US basket, mm-hmm. Both because they have questions about even a second Trump term, but also Biden administration, for the reasons that Yoon said, there are questions about what the China approach will be. Vice President Biden himself has said, you know, that he will back India on the boundary, but that's kind of a broader point of view. There will be concern in India about, you know, will the Biden administration take a more accommodating position? Will it tone down some of the competitive approach? And so will it really be that supportive of India on this, or step back a little bit? So I think it's both because of that, but they're also quite uncertain about whether President Trump in his second term will just say, I want to deal with Xi Jinping, let's make this happen, and leave Asia to the Asians to kind of figure out on their own. So I think, yes, a lot closer than I think it's going to drive some amount of cooperation, but India will continue to both try to build its own capabilities, but also work with other countries, Australia, Japan, France, and the one that's more problematic for the US, Russia.
Right. I want to return to Russia and the EU in a moment. I see Barbara Demick has a question. Barbara, if you could just say who you are, just for the audience.
Yes, hi, this is Barbara Demick. I'm an author and journalist and former CFR fellow. And I apologize, we had ringing doorbells and all sorts of things, so I missed some of the answer. I'm still somewhat puzzled about what the Chinese interest is in this high altitude piece of not very desirable real estate. I've heard, you know, varying explanations about, you know, needing it for control of Xinjiang, needing it for control of Tibet, the Belt and Road Initiative, reaching the port in Gwadar. So I'd be interested in both of your perspectives.
Yun, why don't you take that?
Sure, I'll give it a try. Well, the border dispute between China and India has been ongoing since the founding of the two countries in the 1940s. And I think for this border to be solved, for the Chinese, there's a concept that's consistent, which is the three sectors of the disputed border, the eastern sector, the middle sector, and the western sector, they need to be solved together. There needs to be a comprehensive solution to this. So in the Chinese view, and like Tanvi just mentioned, India has pretty much consolidated its control of Arunachal. Mm-hmm. And that means that for China to hope to gain advantage in the eastern sector, it's unlikely to fly. So for China, a comprehensive solution of the border dispute cannot focus on only one sector. So that's why that when people look at the Western sector and question that, well, for this mountainous, unhabitable area, then what is really the strategic advantage? Well, Tanvi mentioned the military strategic implication of the control of the territory. But I think from a border settlement point of view, the Chinese feel that if the Indian have already consolidated its control on the other two sectors, and now the focus of the crisis or the focus of the solution of the dispute is only focused on the Western sector. Western sector is the only area where China has an almost, well, you can call it advantage, that because China has been controlling Xiaqing, which is a total of 38,000 square kilometers. So for China to only talk about the Western sector of the disputed border ignores the fact that the Eastern sector has already been placed under the Indian control for decades. So I think that's why that for China, concessions or compromises on the Western sector by focusing on the Western sector alone is not an acceptable position. Because if China loses an advantage in the Western sector, then there's not going to be a deal making, not going to be a comprehensive solution to the whole border disputes between the two countries. And I think that's why the Chinese are hanging so much to the Western sector at this time. Thank you.
Terrific. In the time we have left, we've only got about 5 minutes or so. I want to just try to pose to both of you the prospects for third-party mediation. I was struck by the fact that the agreement in September was held in Moscow. Is that because Russia is seen as a quote-unquote honest broker to both sides? Where can the EU potentially play in this, or is it essentially a peripheral player? I haven't really mentioned the UN yet, and I'm assuming that nobody sees any role for the UN in this at all. But in the time we have left, could you kind of give us a sense of, is this something that really has to be settled bilaterally, or can a third party play a promising or fruitful role here? Tanvi, if you start first, then maybe we end up with you.
I mean, you might have a different view, but I think at the end of the day, if this is going to be settled, it's going to be settled bilaterally. President Trump has offered to mediate, but that's in the line of offering to mediate pretty much everything. They asked the Indian ministry and they said, we have mechanisms, and there was one thing that China and India agreed on is that they have bilateral mechanisms to sort it out. I think with the Russians, I think increasingly India does not see them as an honest broker because they are far too tied to the Chinese. But what India was trying to do, I think, by going to these meetings, the SCO, the BRICS, the Russia, India, China trilateral, they went for a couple of reasons. One, they didn't want to upset the Russians because even though they have doubts about the Russians, They need the military spare parts, some equipment, especially in the middle of a crisis. But also they were hoping to persuade, I think, the Russians to try to say to their Chinese friends that, look, why would you want to tank this, you know, China-India relationship and push India towards the US, which is not going to suit either Russia or China, for this kind of flat terrain as Yuna has written before, that, you know, it's one thing to say this is in our interest, but then you have to balance it against others and cost benefit analysis. Is this really worth it? The Russians initially kind of tried to message out in India that they'd be interested in mediating, but then even they backed down that, look, we're just offering the space on the sidelines. And so India attended these meetings, but it did subsequently walk out of the SCO military exercises saying we can't be doing this. So I think that there's limitations to what the Russians can do. The UN, no, because China has a veto, and India, though, will be a non-permanent member of the next 2 years at the Security Council. I think the way you'll actually see this play out at the UN is I think you'll see India voting a lot more with the US and France and others over the next few years. But I think you'll also see them use their Security Council membership to try to say to China, look, we're willing to work with you, but you know, you need to work with us on these other things. So, and the EU, I think they're just not a player in this. France is very much considered a like-minded by India. The fighter aircraft that India's gonna be flying over are French, but I guess they also sell to pretty much everybody. So it's just, they're not a player on this, really.
And they've lost the Brits, of course, who had a more direct role in the past. And so the UK is no longer.
Well, really, and the Brits, I have to say, though, they've lost a lot of traction in India. They just don't have the kind of influence that they did earlier. And people just, you know, they point to them and say, if you had sorted this out, you know, they're sort of part of the problem since they have created this problem in the first place. Right. Jokingly, people say by taking a kind of a marker that was too wide and drawing a line. And so, you know, it's not quite clear on the ground who has what.
Right. Yun, final word to you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Paul. And thank you, Tanvi. I agree with Tanvi. I think this can only be solved bilaterally between China and India. Neither country has the tradition of accepting third-party mediation to settle their border disputes with a neighboring country. And I think in 2017, during the Doklam standoff, China backed itself into a corner and couldn't find a step to really have a face-saving way out of the Doklam standoff. And the complaint from the Chinese at that point was that, well, Russia did not even play a role. Russia did not even try to call for a meeting between China and India. So there is some face-saving way out for the Chinese. But that was only focused on how to de-escalate the tension, not focused on how to mediate a settlement of the border. So even for the meetings that we saw this year, despite the formality and the substance of the meeting, you could see that the nature of the meeting happened in Moscow on October 10th. That was also focused on de-escalation. It's not about border settlement at all. I don't think either country has an interest in accepting a third-party mediation. I think for the Chinese, they would like to look at the things from one perspective that the India side probably would not accept, which is that among the 14 land neighbors that China has, China has settled border disputes bilaterally with 12 of them. And India and Bhutan are the only two where the land border with China, well, for the Chinese, have not been settled. And I think that that alludes to the future direction that I think the Chinese will definitely go a bilateral negotiation. But how is that going to happen? Whether this diplomatic negotiation over a line of actual controls and neither side agrees to the other side's interpretation, and both sides have historical and legal evidence to support their own claims, I think that is a very difficult battle for the diplomats to really sort out. They haven't been able to do so for the past 7 decades. I don't expect them to complete that task in the next 7 years. And I don't think UN will be able to play that role either. It really comes back to whether India and China will have the pragmatic thinking, the pragmatism, to just settle the border and move on these two countries have other strategic priorities, I would like to believe. Either it's domestic or is other front in terms of their foreign policy. Mm-hmm. So I think solving this border dispute is going to be beneficial for both countries, but that's just an academic view. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Yun, and I think I share your sense of what needs to be done. I can't say I'm listening to you both today. I'm reassured that the situation is going to improve dramatically anytime soon, and things, I think, for the reasons you both discussed, could actually get a lot worse. But I want to thank you both for your terrific insights today. This has really been a terrific discussion. I wish we had more time to unpack it further, but we don't. I want to thank everybody on the line today. Appreciate your interest in our work, and we look forward to you joining us for later sessions of this kind. Thank you both, and thank you all. Bye-bye.